That's a concept, Mr. A says, the super pig is gonna show up every time. I better learn that. Every time that happens, it's like adding 10 points to your score. If you can save one error on the actual test, it's roughly 10 points. So, let's make sure you can get two or three or four takeaways from this map. Section four, we are starting on page 1122. Hit me, what are we talking about? What did we miss? You guys remember this? C-L-O-S-E. I want you to label every kind of mistake that you make so you can know where to put your focus and energies. Was it a concept error? Did you miss key language? Did you oops? In which case, make sure to write everything out and use the calculator appropriately. Did you fail to apply one of the strategies that you should have made it easy on you? Or did you get trapped by your enemy? If it's not one of these, you should have it right. Correct. So, first item. Number four. What do you see here? Table of values. These variables are what? They represent function. Yes. They're what part of the function? These are values or ordered pairs in your function. So, yeah, they're a function, but I want you to see them. I want you to see this table and go, oh, I got a bunch of ordered pairs. What do I do with ordered pairs? Plug them in. Why? Because I'll give the answer. Now, here's how you plug them in wrong. You take your first ordered pair, you plug it in, and A works, and I pick it. That's the wrong way to do it. What you do is you take that first order pair, you plug it into every option. Because it will work in A, but guess what? It will work in B, it will work in C, and it will work in D. They set it up so that first order pair works in all of them. That's the next order pair. What happens? Does A work? Does B work? You plug in a 2, you get a 1 for a value? No, you get 0. Does C work? Yep. Does D work? 8 minus 6? Like, I'm ready to plug every word pair into every equation if I have to, but I don't have to. I see. Ordered pair is fundamental cheat. So what did we miss? Was it the strategy? I should apply the strategy correctly. Should have been prepared to plug in every order pair into every single equation. Okay. Next. Sorry? I thought I heard a number. It's the next item we need to discuss. There's something I want to discuss in number 13. Why don't we go there since I don't hear anything from you guys? Let's talk about 13 for a moment. Here's your original equation. H equals negative 16 t squared plus bt plus k. Now they do something here, and I want to talk about from two different perspectives. And one of them is something that your enemy loves to do a lot, so they kind of laid a little bit of a trap to make it difficult for you. But if we use just a little common sense reasoning, even if you don't know what they're up to, you should still get the right answer. What does the C in cheat stand for? C in cheat stands for connections, conclusions. And one of the ways we apply cheat is by looking at the answers. What do you observe in the answers? They all say V equals, V equals, V equals. So by looking at the answers, I know they want me to solve for V. Right? So we're gonna just apply basic algebra skills to get V by itself. okay, algebra students, how do I isolate P? What's the first thing I should do? Add this to the other side, good. I'm gonna add 16 P squared to both sides, so it's gone from this side, now it's on that side. What else?
Minus K.
I'm gonna subtract a K, now it's on this side. And that equals P T, right? So we add this, subtract that, boom. Already, I know the answer's not gonna be, well, let me isolate P, let's continue. What's the next step? So there's your answer. So if you look at the answers and compare and contrast your answers, why should you immediately strike A and C? Or, yeah, A and C.
Minus obvious.
We need minus K, and A and C have plus K. Throw it out. Next, between B and D, if you didn't know what they were up to, why should you still pick D over B? So they both have division with T, but what happened in B? If you left it exactly like that, what happens in the T squared? Right? It's fundamentally different. So I will pick D. Let me now explain what's going on here, what they love to do, I want you to be looking for and be aware of. I don't know why they decided that they're gonna do this, but I see it like every test. They love to have you solve, and then convert it just a little bit further. And one of the things they like to do is to take a fraction that has a common denominator and split it into two separate fractions, and that's what's happening. They took and combined h minus k over t, and then a plus 16t squared over t. It's like they're taking that and splitting it into two separate fractions. Note to self, please file this forward. They do this a lot. Now we can simplify this, right? And we'll just stop with that. And that's why it's d. So, note to self, beware, you get an answer, they like to split it into two separate fractions for some reason. It's just something they're doing a lot. Next. Let me hear from you. What items can we discuss? Yes. Anything before 27? Lots of opportunity for discussion before 27. I want to talk about 15 then. What's up with 15? 15 is simple language. Here's the deal. When we're talking about surveys, experiments, polls that gather data, we're talking about trends for statistics. Write this down. You cannot conclude definitive conclusions. You must use what I call iffy language. You gotta use iffy language. Why? Because I can't say things absolutely, I can only point to trends. I don't know that, I can't say that it will happen, I have to say it's probable, possible, likely, potentially, margin of error. I have to leave myself an out. Because statistics don't work like this, right? Statistics work broadly, generally. I gotta give myself a little bit of an out with my language. So if you look at the answers, if all you did was tell me that number 15 was a poll, survey, or experimental data, and I didn't give you any of the text at all, I can tell you the answer is A, without hesitation. Because why? Treatment X is likely, potentially, possibly to improve the eyesight. What does B say? Treatment X improves. That's a definitive statement. And then it gets worse. Eyesight better than all others. Whoa, whoa, whoa. You're gonna get sued in court for making that claim. C, treatment X will improve.
It will.
You put that in writing? Are my money back? What's going on here? Is that definitive? No, this is a trend. Treatment X will cause a substantial improvement. No. You cannot make those definitive statements. You must use your data like that. You must use iffy language. Give yourself an out. Anything else before number 27? Did anyone struggle with 19? Yes? Okay. There is a strategy I want to give you. Where's my... more broadly, I call it use your units. Your units will tell you what's used. But you guys, how many of you have taken chemistry or are taking chemistry? How many of you have taken physics or are taking physics? Right. So in chemistry and physics, we tend to call this dimensional analysis. Ring a bell? Dimensional analysis, I just said, use your units. So let's start with, what does the question ask for? What are we trying to give them? What are we trying to solve for? Acres. So I want to know how many acres. I always start with what they want from me. And then I say equals. And then here comes your dimensional analysis. What information do they give me in the text that provides acres? Because acres I need in my numerator because that's what I want for an answer. Do they give anything about acres for something or something for acres? Yeah. And one of the ways that, that little language inversion happens to us is we have a football field first is 1 1/3 acres. And so we're likely to do the math wrong. We need 1 1/3 acres, which I'll convert to 4/3, is what? One football field. Okay. Do I want acres for a football field? No, I want acres. So how do I get rid of football field? Well, he's got to go in the numerator so I can cross them out. What more information do they give me with football field so that I can cross it out? For 1 ounce? 7 football fields? Is that what it said?
Yeah.
7 football fields, 1 ounce of graphite, graphene. 7 football fields, 1 ounce. Did they give it to you as 1 ounce, 7 football fields? Or 7 football fields, 1 ounce? Which would they say first? The 1 ounce? Yeah. Again, it's an easy inversion if you're not careful. They gave you the information 1 ounce football field, but we need it inverted. Now, do I want acres per ounce of graphene? No, I got to get rid of my ounces of graphene. I got to get rid of these. What do they tell? What else do they tell me about ounces of graphene? 48 ounces. Is it related to something else, or it's just 48 ounces of graphene? Okay, so it'll just be over the number 1. There's your math. Use the calculator. 48 times 7 times 4/3, that's your answer. Next question. The units tell you what to do. The language is tempting you to invert the math by accident. So, next question. That was 19. Yes? 24? Anything before 24? 23, I assume, would be a cause of trouble for some of you. So let's do 23. We talked about this before, and I promise you it's going to be pretty much every test. So let me remind you of the issue. I think we used a 3-4-5 triangle. Oops. I think we used a 3-4-5 triangle. call those X and Y. And then we also made another extreme angle triangle, call it X and Y. And we said, what must be true in both triangles about X plus Y?
Equals 90 degrees.
Have to, by definition, right? Good? They add up to 90. And here's the conclusion, connections conclusions, that they expect you to make anytime you know two angles add up to 90. What is the sine of X? So, Katoal. Yeah? What is the cosine of Y? And the sine of Y? And the cosine of X. And the truth that we have uncovered again is that the sine of one angle must equal the cosine of the other angle if they add up to 90. So if ever you find that they add up to 90, you must conclude the sine of one is the cosine of the other. In reverse, if they tell you the sine of the one is the cosine of the other, then you must make that conclusion to solve. And in this case, they tell us what? The sine of A equals the cosine of B. Connection conclusion, you must say A plus B equals 90. You have to say that. Go ahead and write that down in your books. A plus B equals 90. Simple. Now what do we do? Now that we made that connection that A plus B equals 90, we use simple substitution, go solve for K. Substitute the value of A, substitute the value of B, go solve for K. Easy peasy. But you must make this connection. This is a hyperfade. It shows up on pretty much every test one way or another. And you'll notice that these two angles are not even in the same triangle. They don't even form a triangle. And what matters is that they add up to 90. What matters is that the sine equals the cosine. So if you missed that one, we're going to call that a concept error. And it's a super popular concept that you want to make sure you plow forward. 24, you're just going to be a little bit irritated, but it's simple language. We give everyone 3 millimeters, right? How many millimeters are left over? Number 24, how many 5 millimeters left over? Okay. I got 5 millimeters. How many additional millimeters do I need? What operation? Additional millimeter. 5 plus 21 equals. Next question. It's not irritatingly simple. 5 and 21 additional. But let me make sure you understand this little caveat. Here's the issue. They all have 3 millimeters to begin with, right? The fact that we're going to give each one of them one additional milliliter, that's what makes it this simple. I got 26 millimeters, not milliliters now. And I'm giving each one one. I'm done, that's it, I'm done, 26. What would be different, guys, what would be different if I wanted them to have 5 milliliters? Then of those 26 milliliters, I'd have to give each of the students 2, so there would only be 13 students. Right? So that did matter. You did have to notice that we're going from 3 milliliters to 4 milliliters, so I'm just giving each student 1 more milliliter. So it's just 26. In addition, why is that doing number 24? That should be number 1. 5 plus 21, 26. Got it. 27. Did you draw rectangles? Why not? Hieroglyphics, because you've got to achieve. Because you've got to achieve more. You got to lay it out for yourself. Okay, so we should draw this first. Why? So we can see what the heck's happening. Let's do it. I got a rectangle. What about it? What's happening? What do they tell me? There's another rectangle? What do they tell me about this other rectangle? The length is increased by 10%. So let me increase the length. What about the width? Decreases by unknown percent. Okay, I'll just decrease it some. I've got a visual going. Longer, narrower. Got it. Now what? What else do they tell me? Area. So his area of the new rectangle decreases by 12%. Decrease. Okay. And the width was decreased by p%, so I don't know what that is. And now I just stare at my drawing and quit. Or I could test real numbers. How long is the original triangle? What's the lazy math number for the length of the original triangle? Sorry? You could use one. Any value you pick will work. But when I'm dealing with percentages, what's my favorite number? 100. I think it's 100. Why? Lazy math. Because if this is 100, what's that? I don't even need my calculator for that one. What do you want the width to be? Now, I was thinking, maybe I can make the width 100 too, but I'm a little concerned about picking the same value. I'm afraid it might do something in the space-time continuum. I don't know. I'm afraid that if I pick the same value, it could affect this negative. So what would be another good value to work with?
10.
I'm going to use 10. 10 is easier. Again, any values you pick will work. But I'm just telling you, these are great values to see easily working with percentages. Great, so what's his area?
1,000.
Oh, his area decreases by 12%. Use the calculator. That means it's 88% of this. It decreases by 12%, it's 88% of. Use the calculator, find out that this is how much? 880. I know what the width is. What times 110 gives me 880? I decreased from 10 to 8. I decreased by 2. Out of 10, 20% easy McPeasy. Trod, use real numbers. The math is easy. Conceptually, it's a pain in the butt. Make your life easy. Why is 28 easy peasy? Because you don't even do math. You just look at the words. There's a 10% decrease, right? Did anybody pick A or B on this one? No? Good. Because what does your enemy like to do? Talk about, see this 10% decrease over here? Yeah, we don't want it. We want to know how many people are left. So if the population decreases by 10%, we need to put in 90%. Does that make sense, what they're doing? So I know it has to be C or D. And what language in the question tells you the answer? How often does this occur? Every 20 years, and from your watcher language sheets, you all know immediately that every means divided by. Watch your language. Look at the language sheet. If you see each or every, it means divided by 20. Every 20. You don't have to do any math here, guys. You just need to watch the language. Anything else? Yes?
30.
Number 30. This is the kind of question I used to see on the old SAT a lot. They're giving you three equations. I don't see a lot on this one, but let's make sure we know how to deal with it. They give you two obvious equations and hide the third one in words.
Yeah.
What's the third equation that we need to write?
B equals C minus 1 half.
Yeah, so let's write that down. B is C minus 1 half, right? Now, the simple way to solve this is always substitute for B, substitute for C. What does B equal based on the first equation?
What is B equal?
Yeah, what is B equal based on your first equation?
2x minus 7.
2x minus 7. And what does C equal in your second equation?
2y minus 7.
2y minus 7. Okay. If you forget to bring down this 1 half, you're burned. But otherwise, just add 7 to both sides. Divide both sides by 2, or that's the same as multiplying both sides by 1 half. If I divide this by 2, what's 1 half divided by 2? 1/4. And it's, again, math is easy. So y, x equals y minus 1/4. But that's a very old popular, it could show up again. You get three equations, substitution.
I got C because I plugged it in, plugged the top two equations, and I rearranged like what C B equals. I got C. But that one.
Okay, do you see where the oops happened?
Yeah.
So probably, as far as the close, that's just going to be O for oops.
Yeah.
How about the last 8? Anything in here? Okay, real quick strategy point that could be very helpful for those of you who hate greater than or lesser than symbols. Anyone here hate greater than or lesser than symbols? Okay. Here's my coaching point. Let's just say it says equals. Let's pretend it says equals. Why? So I can do my math without my head exploding with the, I don't know what's happening. Just pretend it says equals, go do your math and see what happens, okay? Don't let this stop you from doing the math. And 9 times out of 10, it won't matter. Nobody got 35. No one's asking me, but I'm sure you didn't get it. So I brought it up. I have no idea what this equation would look like, but I can guarantee you we can hieroglyphic our way to it, to an answer. Let's use some chicken scratches and figure this out together. As I read this, I see that there's satisfaction ratings 0 to 100. I might just draw this down, you know, just to make sure that I'm keeping my range correct. Inclusive, meaning I could get a 0, I could get a 100, right? Okay. The first 10 ratings, I'm going to give 10 ratings. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Okay. The first 10 ratings. Average 75. Average 75. Now I'm going to add into this a little a little strategy point. Anytime you get questions about arithmetic mean or average, I want you to immediately think, I should get my subtotals and my grand totals. Subtotals and grand totals of what? Points, seeds in a watermelon, whatever it is we're talking about. What's the subtotal of seeds, points, people, whatever we're adding, and what's the grand totals? Okay? We need to apply that here. Because from 1 to 10, what's my subtotal of points? I know it says average class. This could be 75, this could be 80, this could be 70, but the average is 75, so what's the total points? 50. Okay. What's the next? How does it go? What's the least value can receive for the 11th grade? So here's my 11th grading. I want it to be the least value possible. I'll still be able to get an average of 85 for the first 20. 12, 30, 40, 50, 60, 70, 80, 90, 20. All 20 has to have an average of 85, so what's my grand total? But I already have a subtotal of 750, so how many points more do I have left? I still have another 950 points to earn in here to make that happen, don't I? So the question is, how low can you go here to still get 950 points?
50.
Well, I could go, how high can I go for these guys? Because if he's going to be low, they all have to be high. This is going to be 100 each, which will take care of 900 of them, which means I've got 50 left. Bunch of chicken scratches. I didn't do any brilliant equation, I just kind of worked it out. This is a perfect example, guys, of what I mean, use hieroglyphics to work out problems logically. These used to be called math reasoning tests. You can reason your way to the answer. That's not hard math. So, any other questions before we wrap up section 4? John?
What happened?
Any other questions for section 4? Fine. Have your takeaways?